This is Dr. Jerry Hesch. I'm an orthopedic manual physical therapist. I treat the person, I treat the nervous system, and I treat joints, motion. Samantha is in the Air Force. She's had 6 months worth of physical therapy without benefit. She used to be a runner. She used to play soccer, which I think explains what we're going to demonstrate on the ankles. Right now, she's just not doing well. 10 minutes in the car, she has to change the position of the right knee. Well, the foot and ankle are the first shock absorber when we walk or run. And she only has, well, she has zero dorsiflexion. And when I bring each foot up, they're equally tight, to 0 degrees of dorsiflexion, then it's really tight. I can't spring it. I'm trying to thrust it to test joint play, and it's very, very tight. And if we palpate, we come down the foot, at the end of the foot is the talus right there, just about a half inch wide aspect of it, and the tibia is here. Well, the tibia is supposed to be anterior to the talus, and that's not the case. She's living in plantar flexion. And even if we bring it up to that 0 degrees, talus is still forward, okay? This is a joint fixation. You can blame the nervous system. Some people say it's positionally altered. You know, I don't get into that argument. I can't prove that the bony structure moved and became stuck. I mean, it could be driven by muscle. Who knows? I just want to find it, and I want to fix it and improve her function. The subtalar joint is also locked. She doesn't have any eversion. I'm trying to evert that heel. I can't get any of it. Okay, now I can invert the heel. So she's living in supination, which is a rigid position of the foot and ankle. It's the position for propulsion when you're walking. I didn't test the cuboid earlier, but she has good cuboid play. Okay, now I'm going to try and twist the foot towards the midline, and that's called adduction. And she has that mobility, okay? What she doesn't have is outward movement of the foot, which is a deduction in the heel. There's just none. And the foot should come outward to the left, okay? And that's the same thing that's going on in this right foot and ankle. So those are things I wanna treat, and they are easy to treat. So what I'm gonna do, I've seen some techniques where you just glide the talus, but it's very ineffective. You have to scoop the calcaneus, lean on it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 should be enough. I slide up 1 inch. I want to make sure tibia has normal glide. It does. Now that moves more. Okay. Sometimes that'll unlock the subtalar joint. I'm not quite sure why, but it didn't. Okay. So I'm going to distract the subtalar joint, so I'm pulling the heel towards me, and I wait about 30 seconds. I want to just maximize the distraction of that joint made by the bottom of the talus and the top of the calcaneus. A very complicated joint. And then I add abduction, and now we're starting to get a little bit of abduction, okay, and starting to get at least a little bit of play in eversion. So now I'm going to retest it. And now we at least have a little bit of play in eversion. She doesn't have a lot of range. That's just how she's made, okay? But she at least has a little bit of movement that way, and I can actually spring it now. And then in terms of abduction, look how easy. Look, she has, I'm going to call that 10 degrees. It might be a little bit less, but at least she has that movement. So I'm going to do the same thing on this foot. And now when she walks, it's going to find that range of motion. Okay, so if she does nothing to help it along, she will keep that motion that I gave her. And that restriction developed over years of playing soccer, running, and wearing boots in the military. And she wore high heels a lot as an adult. So if she minimizes the use of boots, I guess you have no choice. You're in the military, right?
That's right.
But you're not wearing high heels on your free time anymore, right?
No, those went away years ago.
Yeah. So I'll teach you techniques to make sure that you keep this mobility. Since you still have to wear military boots 40 hours a week, then that's a bit of a concern. So we'll teach you how to self-manage this. You will not need me to treat that again. I do it once, I'm done. Okay?
Okay.
All right. So we're going to treat this critter. Good. I'm going to distract him. Okay. And I'm being just a little bit more aggressive than I usually am. And then you can see I'm now able to get that abduction. Okay. And now we have valgus of the heel, eversion. Okay. And we have adduction of the heel. Okay. Now we're going to focus on the knee. The right patella is very tight. Okay, 6 months of PT have not freed that up. All right, whereas patella on the left, I can slide left and right. I can scoop underneath it and make it pop up slightly towards the ceiling. This one, no. And it's tight going inferiorly and superiorly as well. Okay, why is that patella tight? I'm sure they've done patellar mobs with you and it's not doing any good. Am I correct?
Correct.
They tried.
Gave me taping options.
Taping. Okay. All right. Well, there's a couple of things at play here. If I come right above the patella, I go about an inch and a half above that, and just visually, I can see that this patella is more posterior than this one. That's called a posterior glide fixation, okay? And so that will give her probably, I mean, it usually gives more extension to that knee. Yes, she has about 5 degrees greater extension of this knee, but it tends to reduce flexion. Let me show that to you a different way. I'll look at flexion in a moment. This femur, I can load it to a stop point. That's called taking up the slack. And I can spring it, okay? This one is already stuck in posterior glide. I cannot get any additional movement, okay? So therefore, I can't spring it, all right? So I'm going to look at flexion now. I just want to make sure the camera angle is good, okay? All right, and I have screened her whole body. And I don't find any other patterns in the upper body. And that is 3 fingers to the buttock, okay? This one is more like 4, okay? And that'll be easy to restore. So one of the goals of treatment is going to be to glide that femur forward. And the other effect of a femur stuck in posterior glide is that it has reduced rotation. The rotation of the tibia is normal or free, okay? But internal rotation of the distal femur is absent. I cannot get any internal rotation. I'm going to test this one rotating to the right, the left one rotating to the right. And yes, I can rotate a little bit and I can overpressure it. All right. There's one more phenomenon going on with her body. Maybe from driving, I'm not sure. But she has normal hip extension on both hips, but she lacks internal rotation on the right. Now, I test internal rotation with the leg completely straight. There's no research on that. The research looks at rotation with the hip and knee bent 90 degrees with patient laying on her back or sitting or laying on her stomach. Okay. But on this side, she has about 45 degrees of internal rotation. And if I were to test it the traditional way, I would get a false positive, a false negative. Okay? Because looking at it, she easily has the same amount and I can overpressure it. But when the leg is out straight, which is much more functional, I can roll the left leg into internal rotation. We get about 45 degrees where it stops, and I can spring it. On the right affected leg, symptomatic leg, I can get her to about 5 degrees. It might be 10, but it's certainly not more than 10, and it's very hard. I can't spring it, okay? What I'm gonna do is first treat this glide of the femur. And then I'm going to restore that internal rotation using a very, very simple method. So, what I do, can you scoot all the way towards the end, towards me? Okay. Very good. So, I'm going to increase anterior glide in the right knee joint. So I weave my arm underneath it like this, and then I stabilize the tibia, and I simply lift up. I'm lifting my forearm up. I'm using a fair amount of energy, moderate force. Is that comfortable?
No, not particularly.
Nope. Okay, it won't be long, okay? I'm just gonna do this for about a minute. There's all kinds of techniques you could do. You could keep the knee completely straight and use a strap and lift up on the strap while you're stabilizing the tibia. I'm assuming the physical therapist did not look at your ankles or your hip joint?
She mentioned my hips a few times.
Okay.
Just ensuring that they stay aligned.
Your pelvis?
Correct.
Okay, all right.
And making sure that any movements that I'm doing doesn't have me putting more attention on one side or not like lifting or coming up higher, but
okay.
Definitely never looking at my ankles.
All right. You have some patellar mobility. Do you feel that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I can squeeze it and it pops up towards the ceiling. Just a little bit of play. Therefore, I think that this will spring. I can now move it and load it. So now it's fully loaded and it now springs. Okay, so that's encouraging. The hip rotators are tight. A lot of people just focus on the piriformis muscle. There's so much buzz out there, you know. I like to treat all of the hip rotators. And this technique is so simple and it's a one-time fix. And then I'll have you do this once a week.
Okay.
Okay. You're not going to have to worry about that glide of the knee. And you'll notice that the femur now has internal rotation,
mm-hmm.
The distal femur. Okay. I take this 2x4x8 inch foam. I find the trochanter on the outside of the hip and I put the middle of this under the trochanter. All right. So she's laying on that foam right under my hand. And it is gapping the hip joint. It's engaging the type 3 nerves. They're called mechanoreceptors that are in ligament and in joint capsule. And they are in turn relaxing the hip rotators. Same thing for the tendons and the muscle that I'm compressing. That's inducing relaxation of the hip internal rotators. Okay? So I'm going to leave this here for 2 minutes. And what I'm going to do is stop filming now. After 2 minutes, I'll take this out and I'll demonstrate the change in rotation. Once in a while, you have someone that doesn't change. My wife is one of those. Mm-hmm. I'll never, ever give her more internal rotation. Her son has it. Granddaughter has it. It's hereditary, you know. Mm-hmm. But I think that yours will release, okay? And then we'll see how you feel at that point, okay? So I'll stop filming. Mm-hmm.